I feel so excited and honored that Melanie Cervantes is here today. When I started teaching here back in 2011, Melanie came to one of my first Latina Studies classes and presented in there. And it's just amazing to see all of the wonderful things that Melanie has done over the years. How many folks have heard of Dignidad Rebelde? Right? Woo! Yes, a lot of folks, right? I know in my house I have so much artwork from Jesus Quesada and Melanie all over my house, right? There's sort of, when you talk about artivists, people who are connecting the activism and the art, but really understanding that art is what is going to move people into action. These are artists that really live their values in terms of really being community-based, social justice-based. So really, really excited to have them here. So Melanie Cervantes has never lived far from the California coast, having been born in Harbor City, California, and raised in a small city in the South Bay of Los Angeles. Now making her home in San Francisco Bay Area, she creates visual art that is inspired by the people around her and her community's desire for radical change and social transformation. In 2007, she co-founded Dignidad Rebelde, a graphics art collective that produces screen prints, political posters, and multimedia projects that are grounded in third world and indigenous movements that build people's power to transform the conditions of fragmentation, displacement, and loss of culture that results from histories of colonialism, genocide, and exploitation. Dignidad Rebelde's purpose is to translate the stories of struggle and resistance into artwork that can be put back into the hands of the communities who inspire it. So Melanie has a long list of accomplishments. You know, Melanie and Jesus people have paid for them to go to Europe, to all over the world, right, for them to share their knowledge and their expertise and their art. And so I encourage you all to go to their website and also potentially buy some of their posters and go to some of the protests where they're passing out this art. Because you know you'll see Melanie Jesus at the marches, at the actions, but you'll also read about them, you know, presenting internationally. So without further ado, let's give Melanie Cervantes a round of applause.
I also wanted to thank Alicia and Associated Students of Laney, the Mexican and Latin American Studies Department, and Laney Community Engagement Leaders for inviting me today, and then. Lastly, I want to thank everybody here for attending. You know, anytime we're in a room gathered together, I really think about like all that it took for us to be together at this moment. What were the struggles and the triumphs of all of our ancestors for us to even be here living, breathing? Like where that dream realized in the flesh. So I just want everyone to just kind of take that moment and think about whatever, you have car troubles, you had to rush and get food, all that stuff, like, but we're here together for this moment that will never be again. We're only here tonight, so I want to appreciate that as well. As Alicia said, Jesus and I are part of this collaborative space that we created called Dignidad Rebelde. We started it in 2007, really organically, as we started to share our practices of making things. And initially, it was really just this place where we could collaborate together. But the more time that we spent together, and the more we talked about what fueled our hearts, what fueled our politics, we came to see that we had so much in common in terms of our political formations as young people. I think as teenagers, we were probably both around 17. Our imaginations were ignited when the Zapatistas declared war against the government of Mexico. They had been in formation for at least 10 years. But in 1994, when the North American Free Trade Agreement was signed into law, they knew that this was the sign of having to take up a self-defense strategy, because they knew the alternative would be for these Maya people to be sent into oblivion. It would be an epic proportion of genocide. And so for the first time, as young people, we were able to see a social movement emerge in real time. We weren't just reading about some amazing things that have happened, but you know, like we read about the Black Panther Party, we read about the East LA blowups where young people were fighting for the right to have decent education. You know, all of these things were amazing, but they were always looking back into a time that we didn't live in. They were historical and important, and they shaped us, but this was something that was happening before our very eyes, and we were able to access information about it because of the internet. The Zapatistas use communicate, and for, you know, it's kind of telling in terms of like age. It was amazing, like that you could get communications from the Lacedonian jungle, these communications that we're talking about, what it meant to engage this way. And now it's kind of like, you know, that immediacy of communication, like it could be taken for granted because we're just in it all the time now, but it was like epic at that time. It was like unbelievable. So for us, really being able to engage in telling the stories of our communities has really been the way that we feel empowered as human beings, as political human beings. Like we draw pictures and say things and amplify the messages of our people. And so this is an example of, you know, sometimes people ask, well, what does it feel like to know you're on track? And this is a photo from Francogawa Plaza, more popularly known as Oscar Grant Plaza in 2009, at one of the larger rallies that happened there. And this was a youth organization called Youth Together that was mobilizing multiracial organizers to take a stand. And we took posters out, like Elisa was saying, oftentimes we'll run posters and take them out and give them out to the people that are attending these political actions as an act of solidarity, as a way to be generous, as a way to have that gift. We also increasingly, as our time has changed, I quit my job to do this full time. I had a full time career for nearly 12 years, and now I've been about 7 months full time doing this work. We are trying to commit more time to actually sharing the skills that have been shared with us, passing on the traditions that have been passed on to us, so that more people are empowered, not just with the output of the posters, but the actual skills needed to go from a blank sheet of paper to a mass-produced set of whatever, you know, whether it's posters or other kind of materials. So those two things are kind of at the heart of our practices. We also have kind of like individual practices of our own. We make installations, do all kinds of other things. I think we don't really bound ourselves by limits, but most of what we do is captured in those two photos. These are my parents. My dad's name's Leo. My mom's name is Juanita. My dad's from a border town called Nogales. There's a Nogales, Sonora, which is in Mexico, and a Nogales, Arizona, which is where he really grew up on the US side. And he was fortunate enough because he got to go to school and worked at the same time, but he went all the way through high school, but he worked that whole time because by the time he was like 8, he was being raised by a single mom. And it just the economic reality for a family that came from very little education, but that had a lot of heart and who had the primary caregiver doing domestic work, which was severely underpaid, had to have a second income. So the first thing he started to do when he was a kid was he would take his little red wagon, he would harvest all of the vegetables from the garden that they had and sell them in his neighborhood. And that quickly transformed into actually becoming a farm worker. By the time he was 8 and 9, he was picking cotton. And I didn't know this until maybe 5 years ago, and we were at an exhibit, and he said, I used to do that, and I couldn't breathe because I was so short. as a kid. I couldn't breathe. It was so hot. And cotton grows really densely, and to pick it, it's horrible. So it wasn't a fun thing for him necessarily. But he did a lot of different kinds of migrant work. And eventually, after he graduated from high school, my uncle convinced him to come to the Bay to try to find a factory job. Because at that time, with a high school diploma, you could get a factory job that could sustain a family pretty well. You could still do blue-collar work and feed your family and like have a different kind of reality. And that was very enticing for him. The migrant farm work was inconsistent, you know, it's often seasonal and very challenging and taxing. So my mom, she is from central Mexico, Guanajuato, and she went as far as fifth grade. She was the first person in all of the line of women, kind of probably since time immemorial, to ever be in a formal education system. So that's huge, you know, that she could even get to fifth grade. So for my generation and my sister, we're first generation elementary, middle school, high school, and college graduates. We had to navigate a whole new set of structured systems without really being able to go to our parents for help because they didn't know how to help us. And it's really kind of a miracle, I think, sometimes that we're able to do that. But there's also a loss there. So while I have, you know, like a degree from UC Berkeley, and that's great, and it's opened the door to a lot of opportunities for me, I also can't tell the difference between one plant and another. And we just went on a trip with my aunt and uncle, and everywhere we went, anytime we were anywhere green, my uncle just like, his being was about like talking about what was growing there, and all of my aunts and uncles and my mom, all of them can do that, and all I see is green. And so there's this loss of a traditional knowledge and a way of knowing where we're at and what's around us and what it does and how it can heal and what you can eat, and you shouldn't touch that because maybe you'll get a really bad rash. That is gone because, you know, like it's kind of the compromise of having the formal education in some ways. So my mom comes to Northern California because there's very limited opportunities for her where she's at, a very conservative state in so-called Guanajuato, so-called Mexico, and she comes to live with her brother. And my parents meet in San Leandro at a paper box company and end up getting married 6 months after getting to know each other, which is a little scandalous because they were both with other people when they met. But I never let them live it down. And they've been married nearly 50 years, so I guess it worked out. So that's how I end up having a ton of family in the Bay Area. I had aunts and uncles, and my grandparents lived in Marin in a little cattle town called Marshall. But we're not of this land. Our people are from what we know as Michoacan, what we know as Guanajuato. The place where my mom came from, her grandma, and her grandma, and her grandma, they were all born in that place within a kilometer. Like I've been able to trace back 10 generations. The same land base. So I'm also kind of this first generation in diaspora, away from the land that the women in my family have always known. So that, like, sometimes I feel lost and I'm like, no wonder why. So getting to the Bay, that's how I meet Jesus in 2005. Our love for visual art really broadly, but particularly Chicana and Chicano art is really what started us engaging in conversation. But also I think the values around what it means to be a Chicanista or someone who's been deeply influenced by Chicana feminism, like those values really kind of sparked something else for us. And this perspective really, I think, came from many women who had critiques of how the men in the Chicano movement were engaging in, you know, revolutionary politics. And I mean, I think it's not too hard to guess how women were marginalized, how they were relegated to gendered things like cooking meals, you know, being on the sideline, and much of the history, or many of the histories, because there's more than one history, erased them. So I think particularly in the late 70s and late 80s, these women start to really shape what it means to be coming from an indigenous perspective as Chicanas. And those readings that we did, the ways that we access these ways of thinking, these theories of the flesh, you know, people were thinking about these ideas as they experienced them in their everyday lives, really shaped our politics. You know, I love the saying that Jesus always brings up, the politics that were really emergent for him in the 90s here in the Bay were about sisters being at the center. And that principle aligns with Chicanismo. So you can see how some of the values and politics that we have show themselves in the work. Like this isn't the very first one, this is the second version of my very first print that I printed here at Laney, because that's how I like to screen print. Unfortunately, I believe they've cut the screen printing class from the arts classes that are available here. I think it was like in the last few years that they offered it. I took a Saturday class, it was after I graduated from Berkeley. I came for a Saturday class, and that was where I really was able to finally express in the medium that I wanted to, because I didn't have the equipment, but the equipment was here. The things that I felt, and one of the very first kind of like burning feelings that I had was this grief for one of the really important theorists, Gloria E. Anzaldúa. She died, and they didn't find her body for a couple days because she was at home alone. And like that made me so sad, because it felt like so palpable, the feeling of loneliness, of what it means for folks not to know that you're missing. So aside from all the like kind of intellectual stuff, I just felt like such a big loss in the pit of my stomach, knowing that that was how folks found out that she had passed. And I had seen so many works, portraits, screen prints by other artists of people who had been really influential, you know, revolutionaries. And I was like, God, you know, from my perspective, I would love to honor her in that way. And that was the very first thing I did. I did a piece that said, "Rest in Power, Gloria Anzaldúa." And so I think the content of the work shows some of the ways that we think about what our politics are. And these are probably like the more obvious. I think the other really strong pillar of how we think about the work that we do is influenced by Zapatismo. You know, they took the name of a revolutionary from the 1910 revolution in Mexico, Emiliano Zapata. He was from the south. They're from the south, the southernmost part of Mexico. And they used his name as a way to identify, very much the way they use the balaclavas, the face mask, to identify. And they often say, we cover our faces to be seen. It's kind of sounds like a paradox. But I think the thing for me about them engaging in resistance was that they were actually making impact in mainstream news. They were able to seize control of several cities in Chiapas. Chiapas is one of the poorest, you know, one of the most impoverished states in Mexico, but it has one of the biggest indigenous populations. I think some of what you were saying echoes that, right? Like, there is a class aspect, you know, like there's a racial capitalism that exists. And so to see them resisting this huge force, NAFTA, was incredible. So the name, Dignidad Rebelde, or Rebel Dignity, if you translate it into English, is actually comes from a phrase that the Zapatistas popularized in their communiques, and they emphasized that there is dignity that is alive and well, and it's taken back through the movement. So we adopted that name from one of Jesus's early prints in order to reflect like these ephemeral, temporary autonomous zones that we have. Like every time we organize folks into a space to create and kind of make an utterance of art, to make a space for gathering, to make a space for community building, and that's really about the people, our community. So here you see some pieces. One is celebrating this year, the 22nd year since the uprising. So every New Year's Day, every year we celebrate that. And we really celebrate how the Zapatistas provide us this contemporary example of decolonial resistance and liberation. I feel like their ability to make this desire for autonomy a central demand really gets at an indigenous politic that's not about assimilation. So those two things, Zapatismo and Chicanismo, are like the pillars for how we think, what our politics are, how we take the theories, these ideas, and put them into action. And so that's going to be what I talk about today, some examples of not just the ideas, but how we actually take steps and put things into action. So our studio's based in Oakland. It's in the Fruitvale. Do y'all know where St. Elizabeth is? We're like right across the street from there. So in the neighborhood, we have like really great smells. Like you can smell the panaderia right across the street. It's kind of torturous, but we like it. and we've been there for about 8 years now. So what's important about where we're at, because we're talking about indigenous perspectives, land's always central to the conversation. Where we place our feet is always central. So it's important for you all to know like where we're coming from. And so as Chicanos, for us, it's increasingly important to acknowledge that we're on Ohlone territory, and we just received news that we're going to get the support to do some installations of monuments on key sites in Emeryville, Berkeley, and Oakland that recognize that these are Ohlone sites. So we're really excited about that, because for us, again, being visitors here, it's our way of honoring the folks whose land we're on. And it's really important that even though we identify as indigenous Chicanos, that if we're gonna talk about decolonization, decolonization's central tenet is about land and the restoration of the land rights that the indigenous people have to it. So in a country that's built on settler colonialism, that wants to erase and eradicate indigenous peoples, it's really important that we don't forget, that we speak those things, because there's a violence in forgetting. There's a violence in participating in that amnesia. So that's like one example of how we actively participate. Every time I have an opportunity to speak, I always recognize whose land I'm on. And that's more for me as a reminder to have humility, to recognize where I'm coming from and to recognize the privilege that I have of being able to even be at these places. So one thing I read today, which I wanted to share, and I forgot to write the article name, but I can look it up for you, is this quote, because I thought it was really fantastic. And it was about the way that many cities are having community efforts to change Columbus Days to Indigenous Peoples Days. And it's a complex issue, but I really liked this commentary on it. Quote, if as a society we're generally interested in righting historical injustices against Indigenous peoples, it is simply not sufficient to stop at the refusal to celebrate Columbus Day. We must be willing to identify the very tangible ways that private property, legal jurisdiction and precedence, economic wealth, and the very existence of the U.S. actively work every single day to perpetuate harm in Indigenous communities while offering concrete benefits to the descendants of settler colonizers. And then we must engage in politicized allyship to advance a movement for decolonization that brings this system to its knees. This is a quote from Jess Kiran Dillon, they're writers that are based in Canada, so-called Canada. So I just wanted to share that as I move forward with some of these examples of what it means to take action, because I just thought it was phenomenal. I read it right before I was coming. I was like, I gotta add that. So practices. When I look up practices in the dictionary, there's two primary definitions. The actual application or use of an idea, belief, or method as opposed to theories about such application or use. It's praxis. It's when the rubber hits the road. It's walking your talk. It is whatever kind of metaphor, but it's like doing the thing, right? And the second definition is to perform an activity or exercise, a skill repeatedly or regularly in order to improve or maintain one's proficiency. So some of these practices that I'm sharing today are about both. It's about actually doing something that brings the theory in the flesh into an active space that I activate in my body, that Jesus activates in his body, that we do something about, but also about getting better at what we do, getting better at how we draw, getting better at how we print, getting better at how we do skill sharing so that someone else learns the same steps that we've learned to do things and improves upon it. So that's kind of the buckets that I'm gonna put these examples in. So we'll start with Thanksgiving, since it's coming up. So I hate having to go home. I mean, I love seeing my family. I love being with my family, I do. And it's quite unfortunate that this is like one of the times where we're able to have like time off, often from school, from jobs, and be able to gather. But I'm always like there, I mean, especially in college, because in college you get that like, I was an ethnic studies student, so you get that kind of like, I hate everything, everything's so messed up, and I had to go home, and I was just like, God, and I would always want to say something, you know, like, you know, people are saying things, and so, as that happens every year, like a few years ago, I just really felt inspired by that year. Friends who had really been just incredibly brave. Some I would say intertribal friends, because it was Ohlone people and other folks under Indian peoples organizing for change, decided that they were gonna do an encampment in so-called Vallejo. It's Sogorate, that's what it was originally called. And they kept that encampment for months because they wanna put trails on a sacred shell mound, a sacred burial site. They wanted to put bathrooms on the sacred site. And up to that point in November, and a cultural easement was arrived at with another tribe. It wasn't the people that actually did the encampment. And it was historic. It's the first time in the history of the nation that's ever happened. So I was so excited at this small group. It wasn't massive like Standing Rock. It was maybe 20 people on a given day were able to make this impact. And I was Thanksgiving Day. So I made a piece on my computer using photos that I had shot at the encampment, and I started to put this thing about what am I actually giving thanks for? And I was the continued indigenous resistance that gets eclipsed when we have days like Columbus Day and Thanksgiving that celebrate agents of empire, the harbingers of death for people. So I was I'm gonna flip the script. Even if it's just this little picture, and even if I just put it on my computer, at least I get to have some kind of experience to say something different. And so I did that first time, and it was really it did something for my spirit more than anything. But then I shared it, and I didn't realize, because that wasn't really the goal. I was I will, because I always put everything on Facebook. It's nice to have it. It's almost a little photo album. That's really how it started. It's this is a good place for me to just keep everything organized, but I can also share it with folks. And it went viral. People had so much to say and started sharing about their experience with folks in the camp if they were local, and then people from other parts of the country started commenting, didn't know about it. And then I was like, whoa, this was really amazing. It's not what I expected. So I've kept that as a practice every year. It's something that I could do in the midst of my grumbling around here on the table for Thanksgiving, and whispering under my breath, this is about genocide, right? Whatever, all the grumblings of why is this the day that we come together? But understanding the complexity of what it means to be working in working class families. So that's one. It's for me, it was such a small practice, a little act of resistance. But I wanted to start because it started at home, in the most intimate place at home with my family, complex as families can be. And it was something small that I could do. Another practice that I think we increasingly, as we have more time to be able to do this, but even in the past 10 years have really aimed to do, is to amplify the voices of movement actors. So for us, we've maintained the tradition of creating solidarity posters. This isn't something new, we didn't invent it. It's a tradition that's been happening for at least 100 years. In the Americas, the Cubans in particular during the 70s were quite proficient and really wonderful at creating models that disseminated these solidarity posters. They had this magazine called the Tricontinental, where they would have your teeny bopper fold out in a magazine. I don't know if that's still people understand. I remember as a kid, I used to buy something like Bop, and there'd be New Kids in the Block in the middle. So instead of that, you would have a political poster, and it would say the Cubans are in solidarity with the Black Panther Party, and they would disseminate these magazines globally. And so they're a huge influence on us. So we're continuing that tradition of creating these solidarity graphics and disseminating them on multiple platforms in order to, one, send a love letter to the movements that we are deeply inspired by, but also to call people's attention to what's happening. Whether it's the uprisings happening in Ferguson, or the movement that's happening in Standing Rock, or the struggle in Arizona around dehumanization of migrants. We've created hundreds of pieces to lift up these struggles. And it's really been something, again, like almost like the practice of doing something at home. It's a way that we have to activate as people who make visual work and take a stand. And so for us, in this moment, it meant creating graphic, because he's created this graphic that's gone really viral to really address what's happening with this $3.8 billion pipeline that Texas-based energy transfer partners want to and are in the process of building. It would take 570,000 barrels of crude oil a day. And unfortunately, yesterday, an hour before the debates, it was announced by the U.S. Court of Appeals that they would be declining the Standing Rock Sioux Tribe's request for a work stoppage. So today was a big day of action. There were 27 arrests. People, I think, at sunrise went to do prayer. There were tipis, at the different sites where the pipeline's built, probably about 80% of the way through. There were people also in lock boxes. You know those, you guys know what lock boxes are? It's like when people put their arm through those barrel shapes and cuff themselves so they'll have to be cut out. So from what I've read and from reports from people on the ground, the amount of aggression that's being used by police, militarized police forces, is increasing. But we also sent a lot of stuff to Standing Rock directly. I mean, this is often the case. We're often like, who's driving there? Whose trunk can we, you know, carve some space out of? We have like 200 posters we want to put in your trunk. Or who's flying? We can pay for luggage fees if you take this big heavy box of stuff. So we've done that. We haven't yet been able to visit, but we're trying to figure out when we'll get there. But in the meantime, we've been in kind of production mode in alliance with other folks. So there was a big art build that created a lot of the banners that folks are carrying now. Those were sent from Oakland. It was a big crew of folks from Oakland producing that stuff. There's like art from folks like Isaac Murdoch, who's native, Sadie Redwing, who's also native, and we did some pieces, and so these are like screenshots of some of those pieces that got sent out there. The other kind of fun thing that I hadn't done before was we did a kind of like an exhibit of work, because I've been collecting work that has to do around the fight in Standing Rock, just again in an album on Facebook. It was just kind of like, I want to aggregate all this work, and that got shared like, I don't know, 1,500 times. Again, it was like something I was doing like, oh, I like seeing them, I would like to see them all in one place. But out of that, an invitation to do kind of like a guerrilla exhibit on the walls of City Hall. There was a big projector that we were able to set up with a mobile generator, and so we projected these images, and I kind of was like a docent. They had a mic, and I was like telling people who the people were. It was really interesting. I'm usually not kind of like up front like that, talking about other people's art, but it was a way to bring consciousness to folks about all these different perspectives that folks had from all these different indigenous nations, because most of the artists are indigenous. So another thing, another aspect of solidarity is kind of like the national solidarity between folks. So for us, for me as a Chicana, as a non-black person of color, my freedom and my liberation are inextricably entwined with the liberation of black folks. Like, if I wanna be free, there's no way that I can be free until black folks are free too. So for me, even before the Black Lives Matter movement had emerged with such force, like the works that we did, the solidarity works that we did were coming from that perspective. So then when Black Lives Matter actually emerged as a movement and just caught on like wildfire, it was really important for us to pay attention to the political development that was happening in the movement as well. And so as people were struggling for their liberation, I think one of the wonderful things has been the efforts that people have had to insert into the conversation, to really emphasize in people's analysis a more inclusive and intersectional approach to talking about how people are being impacted. And so when folks would talk about Black Lives Mattering, it really meant always being intentional about talking about Black women and Black members of the LGBT community, but particularly trans folks. And so this perspective, like for me, was really key to my analysis also, like to developing how I was thinking. And so I think even before, like I was saying, before this movement started, it was important to recognize as a non-Black person of color that white supremacy is fed by anti-Black racism. Like I know, again, going back to being at home, even like on Thanksgiving, you know, I hear all kinds of smack come out of my family's analysis. And so it's, and a lot of that comes out of ignorance and fear. And so like, how do we address it, even in the most intimate of our spaces? So like, we have to fight that anti-Black racism that's happening in those places, because we can't get to where we wanna be without that. So these pieces are not in chronological order, but the approach of being able to like lift up and tell the stories of folks has been some of the examples that I would say we've had of how we've showed alliance with the struggle for Black liberation. So this. Artist. Much less than some of the men. And so this was like one way of trying to storytell. And so my friend, Rob, did the illustration, I laid it out, and we put it out together. And then the other piece, I think I kind of mentioned before, is like one of those general solidarity pieces. This actually came out of visiting home after, it was in August of 2014, after it was announced that there wouldn't be an indictment against the police officer who had killed Michael Brown. I was visiting home, and I actually had family from Mexico, and they were really talking about Ayotzinapa and the disappearance of the 43 students. And in this home where I had heard so many, you know, like off the cuff racist comments from people like my dad, there was like this conversation about the structures of racism. Like there was just this very different conversation happening about police brutality, state repression, and it was incredible. Like I couldn't believe it. I couldn't believe this conversation was happening and that they could be connecting the dots that way. And so in listening to these elders in my family who were in the best surprising way talking about this perspective, you know, that they're not like college educated folks, it's just like my dad worked at paper box company. It catapulted me to go to the place that I know. It's like making the solidarity piece. So the funny thing is, this is a portrait of my friend Robbie, who I had run into on the street, and I said, hey, I drew a portrait of you. I don't know what for, but I just wanted to let you know that when we did that photo shoot like 4 years ago, I just came across the picture and it was awesome. And so I had this portrait, and little did I know that Robbie and a bunch of other folks would be shutting down West Oakland BART, because this was right before Black Friday. And it was just serendipitous that it happened in many ways, because I put it out, and the day I put it out was the day that they had stopped the train from running. And I was like, that's just a coincidence, because I didn't know anything about it. I was really inspired because it, you know, it was a great risk to all the folks that engaged in that action. And at the same time, I was like, and like a lot of the organizers that we know here in the Bay are like badass and like the most inspiring people with the biggest hearts that you can imagine. So in some ways, I was like, and it's also not a surprise. And then so I just want to add in a couple of other pieces. These are earlier works. The one on the left is actually the piece that all those youth were holding in 2009, and it was a way to deal with the grief after Oscar Grant was killed. I was really triggered. This was like the first really kind of public conversation about police brutality that was kind of happening on a large scale, and it really triggered a lot of memories of how police behave and how the structures of policing destroy people's lives. Like, I had friends in middle school who would get dropped off in rival territory, and there was like one young person who was killed. I was like, that was a death sentence. They knew that something bad would happen to them. I don't know if they knew who would be killed, but they knew who would at least get severely hurt. So when Oscar Grant was killed, even though I didn't know him personally, it evoked a lot of the feelings. It evoked the trauma of having to experience that as a young person. And so we started doing like these series of pieces, and kind of getting back to this conversation about how anti-Black racism lives if we feed it. Part of this messaging comes before Black Lives Matter emerges, was about addressing our communities. I was like, if I wanted to put a piece in front of my mom, like, what would it say? And so that's how we started making these pieces. It was the year after Oscar Grant was killed, and we were asked to do a reflection about what happened. You know, like, we, by then we knew what would happen with Meserly, like many of the other police, not much. And so that was a practice of solidarity, one practice of solidarity that we used. So this piece on the left, one of the things that is a little bit different about it was actually trying to connect the dots internationally also with the way that the taxes that we pay to the government are used to slaughter people. So like connecting the dots between the taxes that go to pay for BART police to the funds that go to Israeli Defense Forces. And so that's what the messaging of that piece was about. A lot of people don't know. I think they just thought it was a pattern in the background. That's actually a photo of a mass grave in Gaza. So it was funny because some people would get this online and cut out the message about Palestine, but they would leave the image. And I was like, well, you can't cut it out. It haunts the image. It's there. You can't erase it. You can't erase the connections. This is a good segue. So the last example I have of a practice is also the way that we have international solidarity. And for us, it's really about thinking about settler colonialism as a practice. It's not just like colonialism of the past. It's not just, you know, these monarchies that wanted to have like a colony for resource extraction. It's about current day settler colonialism that wants to erase people from the place that they're from, that wants to obliterate them, take them out. So for us, the Israeli occupation of Palestine is that. And given that it's the fifth decade of this violence, of these abuses, it's increasingly important as we talk about these issues to continue to think of them in a global context. Because the violence and terror that happen are linked. So in addressing kind of like these modes of domination, like settler colonialism, it's important for us to also like articulate our perspective on these things that are happening. So we also do works that address issues that are happening outside of the US. And we also do those works within the US. So like the Peace on the Rights one that Jesus did, and it was used for the Nakba commemoration in San Francisco. But we also, you know, ally and support organizations. So there's an organization at San Francisco State of young people that are organizing around these issues. And so that piece on the left, I did for them. I did it as a fundraiser because we know how under-resourced a lot of things that we care about are. And that's maybe like another practice. We often do that. We partner with organizations and try to support and leverage finances through the sales of work. That's the last example. And I want to close with this piece called Inlakesh. Inlakesh is a Mayan precept. Precept's like a rule or a way of being that's intended to regulate how you behave. It's kind of like, you know, act right. So this has become really popularized by Luis Valdez. Luis Valdez was the founder of Teatro Campesino. Teatro Campesino was like the arm of theater that was used in United Farm Worker organizing. He's kind of seen as the godfather of Chicano theater in that way. So in the late 70s, he really studied this guy, Domingo Martinez Paredes, work. And Domingo Martinez Paredes really studied Mayan culture. And he was a professor at UNAM, the National University of Mexico, in Mexico City. And in the 70s, we saw this, came across this translation from Maya into Spanish. And we saw this translated from Spanish into English. And so I have the English and Spanish on here. But I think this precept really encapsulates not just the politic, but a worldview and perspective that we really try to engender. So it reads, Inlakesh, you're my other me. If I love and respect you, I love and respect myself. If I do harm to you, I do harm to myself. So I wanted to close with that because I think that gets closest to our heart. You know, like there's a lot of $5 and $10 words that a college education has brought me, but I haven't always had them. And I feel like this, these words are like very accessible and they get to the very heart of why we do what we do and how we do what we do, because we do see ourselves as interconnected inextricably. And with that, I'll close with some ways to stay in contact with me. Thank you.
Indigenous peoples is the nation state itself, right? So following these constructed borders are also violent. And so in our organizing, even what we do locally and what we do within different states, right, we have to think about even beyond that, beyond our nation state borders.